We're glad you're here. Thank you for joining with us. Lord, I pray specifically just calm my own spirit, my own nerves this evening, and bring a sense of peace and real shalom to this room. Lord, as we talk through some tough and timely topics, we're going to ask for your grace, Lord, and we believe you'll distribute it freely upon us. Grace where there could be condemnation, grace where there could be legalism, grace where we could almost picture in our mind's eye individuals that have walked through things in life that have been painful, sexual things, hurt, abuse. Lord, there's just so many things in this room and people that we love and cherish outside of this room that these topics could affect. And so we pray for your grace, your amazing and abundant grace to wash over us. So Lord, teach us, just as the disciples were taught by you, Jesus, to pray. Lord, teach us to understand the scriptures, even how to study them, how to look deeper than just the surface level, and how to really own our faith and how to be able to articulate it. Lord, we ask for you to be with us this evening and speak to us in a very profound way. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Okay, now, here we go. Let me give you just some house rules here. Just a little bit of house rules, and then we're going to dive into this lesson. For starters, if you need to use the restroom, you know where it is. It's out in the lobby and off to the right. The restrooms are out there. If you need refreshments or things, there's over in the cafe and the kitchen area. Feel free to get what you need. I don't think there's any children here. Do we need to do the PG-13 talk? I don't think I see any. Shelby? Go to the nursery right now. No, Shelby. I love it. No, I don't think I see any kids. We don't need to worry about that. But if there was a need, we do have a room, and it's got a video link, and we're also filming and we're videoing this. So if you want to watch that in another room, you're more than welcome to. I'm going to be the primary voice tonight. Sorry about that. You hear me talk a lot, probably on the weekends, but I'm the primary voice tonight. This is, I'm not putting that on anyone else. I did tease my wife when she came in. I said, do you have your portion of the lesson ready for tonight? And she's like, what? You know, I'm like, yeah, you're talking about, so no one else is sharing. It's not necessarily an open forum. If we have time, we may get to questions. Man, if I'm moving too fast, or if I hit something that you kind of go, wait, could you repeat that? I just lift a hand, just raise it, and we'll just go back. I think that is the place where we can have some interaction. Rather than raise your hand and kind of cutting in or wanting to debate, let's hold on to that. We could do that privately. We can certainly do that in a question format afterwards if there's time. But the reason I would say don't do it during it is because I'll probably get to that at some point, and we just don't need to sidetrack. But also, there's going to be such varying views in this room, and so that's why I guess I'm up here, and we're just going to hear a particular way of approaching some big topics, okay? So, you ready to go? Yes? Yes? No? Maybe so? Okay. Let's talk about sex. That's what I wanted to start out by saying. Let's talk about sex. Remember that song? All right. All too often, and by the way, as we talk about sex, I'm going to be staying pretty closely to my notes today. So if you see me looking down, it's because I'm working through my own notes so that I don't find myself getting off into the deep weeds and not being able to double back and figure out where we're at in the flow of this topic. So, all too often, I think in the church, we become embarrassed to talk about this kind of stuff. We become embarrassed. How many of you remember getting embarrassed when your parents talked to you about sex, or when they talked to you about the birds and the bees? Anna was the first person that raised her hand right there, my daughter. Or you remember not having that discussion. That was a discussion that didn't really happen in my own house. I wrote a small little book about teaching and raising boys, in particular talking to your boys about sexuality. And in it, I refer to my dad's battery aisle discussion. The battery aisle discussion was right before I had gotten engaged to Denise. So I was all of about 18 and a half years old. And we were standing in the battery aisle of a store called Best. And it's not Best Buy, but it was a store called Best. And they went out of business. And my dad walked up to me, and we were looking literally at batteries. And he began to him and haw and talk to me about, I finally realized, Dad, what are you trying to say right now? Are you wanting to talk to me about sex? Well, yeah, I probably think I should probably do that now. Dad, I'm getting married in a couple months. It's like, this would have really been helpful a lot of years ago. And so this is a day and age in which, you know, maybe a lot of you have had a birds and bees talk, or you didn't have a birds and bees talk, but we're in a different culture right now. Not only do we have the birds and the bees, we've got the bees and the bees, we've got the birds and the birds, right? And I was talking to my friend Chris Buck, who's here tonight, and we now have bees who want to wear feathers, and we've got birds that want stingers. You know what I'm saying? So you getting the connotation? There's a lot of nuance. There's a lot of gray area. There's a lot of things in the culture. And because of all of this, not only are parents embarrassed to talk to children about that, but pastorally and even within the church in America, we've become increasingly fearful. We've become fearful because of confusion. We just don't know what we believe about it. We become fearful or embarrassed because of issues of tolerance, political correctness, and admittedly, here's the deal, the church, I'm putting that in big air quotes, the church has been late to the party. It's been late to the party on these discussions regarding sexuality and a sexual ethic, which I'll describe what that means in just a little bit. And when we actually arrive to the party, here's what oftentimes happens. We end up just yelling at everyone who's having fun, right? They think they're having fun. They think this is the best thing ever. And the church ends up only sounding mean or reflective of a God who we think is just one massive cosmic killjoy. He's always out to just ruin our fun and to keep us under thumb. And then what happens is if we see or perceive that a big portion of the church is yelling at the world, telling them to stop everything that they're doing, and they're going straight to hell if they continue, what happens is then a sector of the body of Christ will knee-jerk and go the other direction and not talk about it at all. Why? Because they don't want to be lumped in with this group. They don't want to have to associate with those that are yelling or screaming. And then we get to where we're at in our culture, where by and large the church has become voiceless. They're not speaking up about really, really important issues. And so discussions regarding sexuality have become, I think, nearly extinct in the local church. We're just not talking about it. And you may say, well, why aren't we meeting right now on a Sunday morning? Why aren't we gathering during our regular church hour? Well, we're doing this on a Wednesday night because there are things I want to talk about where I want to do it in a format that would begin to allow for the dialogue and allow for the conversation to take place that we could in the future begin to talk about this more readily to a larger segment of our church, but to do it with grace, with transparency, with foreknowledge, with a biblical ethic that we could, as leaders or as individuals that are concerned about this issue, we could come into it with. Rather than just coming to the church on Sunday morning and say, let's talk about this now, I'd rather do this in another setting like we are tonight and then allowing our church to ease into these discussions. Now, don't let there be a fear in your heart that all of a sudden now everything we talk about is going to be of sexuality on a weekend service. It isn't. But to be able to have these conversations because many people are hurting badly over issues such as what we're going to get to tonight. And there really becomes, I think, a lack of ministry from the local church and a lack of ministry from pastors specifically in this area. And one of the reasons that we don't minister in this area is because we're fearful of accusation, okay? Fearful of accusation of being unloving, judgmental, legalistic, and guilt-mongering, okay? Everyone with me so far? This idea of if you're a pastor, if you're a Christian leader, that if you even talk about an articulation of what you believe the scripture says about sexuality, that somehow you're intolerant or somehow you're judgmental or somehow you are fear and guilt-mongering and you're bringing about condemnation, all right? All of those things will not be a part of what we're doing tonight, all right? We want to just speak truthfully out of the scriptures with a lot of compassion and grace, okay? So we're going to talk about sex. We're going to talk about various topics connected to sexuality, but we're going to do it with a particular set of rules. Now, I want to show you how we're going to get to these rules. I've given you this handout, and it's only for you if you like it. If you're the kind of person that needs to know when we're going to be done. Okay, you're smiling, right? Like, how close are we? You ever look at the programs at like choir concerts or orchestra concerts for your kids? You're always like, what song are we on? Okay? So I've given you two pages of an outline, and then I'll refer to the other pages. If you're the kind of person that doesn't need that, or if you just need the white margins just to capture some notes, to each his own. But we're going to follow along in this outline. And I want to talk to you about the set of rules that we're using to address sexuality and a sexual ethic. The first way we're going to approach this is, just like the title says, biblically. We're going to approach it biblically. So friends, here's the deal, and I make no qualms about this. I know we are a Bible church. Okay, I'll see if anyone's leaving. Okay, we're a Bible church. We believe in the Word of God. This is our final authority, all right? And I approach what I'm going to talk to you about tonight with a, quote, biblical ethic. Now, what is an ethic? An ethic is a governing moral construct. You may want to grab that. A governing moral construct, okay? It's in direct opposition, by the way, to what's been called relativism. Okay, relativism is a doctrine that knowledge, truth, and morality exist in relation to culture, society, or historical context, and they're not absolute, okay? Did everyone catch that definition? You don't have to write it down, but just be thinking about it. And you already know this because this is the culture we're living in today, okay? We're living in what's called moral relativism, okay, where there is no absolute, where anything goes, and it's based upon the connection to what someone would deem to be truth, and that could be anyone that would deem it to be truth. It could be your truth, quote unquote, all right? Or it's whatever exists in relation to society. So if society has moved, well, then that target just continues to move. We don't hold to that. We hold to the fact that the Bible is the absolute truth. Now, we could talk long this evening, but we don't have the time. There's going to be a lot of things we don't have the time to talk about, by the way. But we could talk a long time about biblical interpretation. That's a whole nother study of how we actually interpret the Word of God. That would be worth talking about at some point down the road. But this is the Bible, and we hold to it. Okay. Secondly, we're going to approach this compassionately. All right? So with the Bible, that many people hold, like I'm holding it right now, we could use it as a tool, we could use it as a resource, we could use it as a guiding light unto our feet, unto our path. We could use this as a way of learning and growing and being challenged and corrected and rebuked, like the scripture says. All scripture is useful, all right? Or we can use this to just beat people up. And by the way, throughout culture, throughout society, it's being used in that way. That we could use it to beat people up, we could use it to rip on people, to belittle people, but we're not going to. We're going to speak compassionately, and I want to approach this compassionately, understanding that there are various viewpoints, various stories. By the way, I don't know all of your stories, but I would hazard a bet that in this room, there are people that have loved ones that are affected directly by homosexuality, by same-sex attraction, by abuse, by rape, by pornography, by adulterous affairs. I mean, you see what I'm saying? And we don't have to go far. We could just talk to the first two rows and probably have 8 to 10 people in these two rows who say, yes, I'm directly affected, or I have someone close to me, and then work your way all the way back. And we have hundreds of people in this room. So we're very compassionate towards that. And we're also very compassionate towards the degrees of discipleship that exist within this room. So there are some that are further along in their walk with Jesus, right? There's some that are just growing, just learning. And we're going to live in the light in which we have right now. The book of Philippians says we're going to live up to what we've already attained, meaning we're going to let the Lord move us, and we're going to allow the Holy Spirit to speak to us. So we're going to be very compassionate. Okay, third thing, and this is kind of a construct for us, how we're going to approach this. We're going to approach this briefly. Briefly. We could talk all day long about this, okay? We will go over an hour, so just kind of buckle up, all right? But this evening can't be exhaustive. It can't be, some of you are probably thinking it's already exhaustive, Phelan, but it can't be comprehensive. We just don't have the time, okay? We don't have the time to hit on every topic, which is why in your packet, I've given you a resource list, and it's got a series of books, most of which I've placed right up here, but also a number of others that I could point out to you. And in pointing them out to you on that list, I want you to understand that I've read most of them in their entirety. And if I haven't read most of a particular book, I at least have a familiarization of it enough to know I could recommend it to you. Okay, by the way, you can't go into a book. What bookstore still exists right now? Barnes & Noble? Okay. Isn't it weird? We don't know which bookstore exists anymore. Borders, Barnes & Noble, Barnes & Noble. You can't just go into Barnes & Noble, into the religious section and look for humans or the human sexuality section and just kind of grab things off. You know this. Okay, but a lot of Christians don't quite understand this, that even if it's in the Christian section, for you to grab it and think that you can just read it and buy it hook, line, and sinker is not, it's not true anymore. There's a number of different persuasions, and we understand that there's a lot of controversy around the idea of human sexuality, same-sex marriage, around a sexual ethic, and a lot of churches are debating this. There are churches that are splitting wide open over these issues. There are denominations that are splitting. I spoke with a man yesterday from a Presbyterian tribe, basically the Presbyterian Church, and their particular Presbyterian Church has broken off of the global Presbyterian churches and says, we will not stand with you because of your stand regarding same-sex marriage. So, and ordination of pastors that are homosexual. So there's a lot of controversy here, all right? We could get into all of that, but we have to be brief. Okay, if you want to pursue more, you can look on that list. And then fourthly, we're going to approach this humbly. I do not have all the answers. I don't know everything. I don't know it perfectly. I don't even know the scriptures perfectly. Okay, we see through a glass dimly, the Bible says. Okay, we don't know it all. And there's no know-it-all in this room. And we may have different approaches to this, and we're just going to be humble towards one another. Okay, is that a deal? Can we do that? All right, thank you. Now, in order to be brief, I have to tell you what I'm not going to talk about, okay? This is a classic preacher move. Let me tell you what I'm not going to say. And by the way, when I say it, I'll probably add a few points of commentary, and you're going to go, I thought you weren't going to talk about that. Well, we're preachers, and we just do this. And so we go off on a tangent. But I want to hold myself to this, and here is some parameters of what we're not going to talk about. We're not going to get into political and legal implications. Okay, we just can't do it. This is not the forum for it. There's been a lot of things being voted into law. Now, here I go. I'm kind of going to go off on it in a second. A lot of things have been voted into law that don't line up with the scripture and don't line up with Christian practice. I think we understand that in this room. Okay, we're not going to get into that. We're just going to believe that what's taking place culturally is another reminder to us that we are not of this world, okay? We're not of this world, and we are about establishing the kingdom of God, not the kingdom of America, not the kingdom of sexuality, not the kingdom of tolerance, okay? We're about establishing the kingdom of God, and in particular, and here's why I have to be careful, is in the particular, we understand some of the implications of regarding same-sex marriage and that becoming the law of the land. And by the way, friends, I just want to tell you, I'm not freaked out about that. I'm not freaked out. That doesn't freak me out. It's very reflective of our culture. It's one more indicator that this is not our home. It's one more indicator that we're building a different kingdom than what's being established. So with that may come some questions, and this is where I could get myself in some trouble. Well, the whole night I could get myself in trouble, by the way. Can we just have a lot of grace for one another here? And I just want to say, even though I said I wasn't going to talk about political or legal ramifications, I've had people ask me, same-sex marriages receive the same rights as other heterosexual married couples? My general response is yes. It's the law. Where it is legal, it's the law, and I think that might be something that is part of the culture we're living in. Do I love it? No. But should they receive the same benefits? I think yes. I've had people ask me, will you marry same-sex couples? And my response is no. Why? Because I'm constrained by the scriptures. I'm constrained by the scriptures. I'm also constrained by my Foursquare bylaws and my license and my ordination as a Foursquare pastor. I can't. I simply can't. Even if I was asked, I would be removed as a pastor. Some of you are probably very thankful for that. But my answer would be, no, I will not. I've been asked this question. John, would you attend the wedding ceremony of a friend, of a same-sex couple that were your friends? And my answer would be, maybe. Maybe. I'd take it case by case. Do you know Jesus hung out in some places that were pretty unsavory? Do you know he hung out with a bunch of people that he didn't fully agree with, right? And so I would take that into advisement. I would pray. I would ask the Lord. And it's quite possible I would. I would attend. And I, again, don't fully agree. And yet, if you were to ask me, do I care for these people? I would say yes. And I'd love to celebrate with them. And I don't celebrate their entire lifestyle, but I would probably attend their wedding. And so not everyone would agree with that, but I'm just giving you a few examples of where we could move into a legal slash kind of political realm, but it brings up so many issues. And even as I say that, it's possible you may think, well, I'm going to tune you out for the rest of this thing because you just said something. And that's where we're going to need to have a lot of grace for one another as we continue forward. Okay, what else am I not going to say? Well, secondly, you'll see on your outline, I'm not going to get into every imaginable viewpoint or every point of extra-biblical material. Extra-biblical, what I mean by that is everything ever written on the subject. There's no way we can do it. Nor can we deal with every viewpoint that you may hold. Okay, there's just so much written. And by the way, the arguments that are being written are very compelling. Very compelling. I'll give you one example. There is a very popular book, and I have it in my office. I don't have it here this evening. It's a very popular book by a young gay man called God and the Gay Christian by Matthew Vines. And this book is sweeping everywhere. And many, many, many individuals, Christian individuals, are espousing this particular book in university settings, all over. It's become very highly sought after book. Now, I would love to go through that book with you and show you all the underlines and comments I've made in the margins, but I just don't have the time. We can't go through every argument. But what I've done is I've included, in that particular case, I've included in this resource list a web link where you could go to Timothy Keller out of New York, Redeemer Presbyterian Church, that has refuted that book and done a very good job of making a strong case against these super compelling arguments. When I read Matthew Vine's book, my heart breaks for this young man. And I want to espouse what he's saying because of the passionate way that he's communicating, and yet we just can't biblically. And so we can't get into every imaginable viewpoint or every extra biblical material, nor can we finally, as I look at this, what we're not going to talk about, we can't get into every personal bias or every feeling or every story, every person, every perhaps child that you've given birth to or you've parented that is exploring same-sex attraction or has been struggling in certain areas or individuals that you know that are good people. And yet, as we move on, we're going to begin to understand the ethic around sexuality. And we have to be careful that we don't just elevate the story over what the scripture is saying. Everyone with me so far? Okay? We can't get into all that. We can't get into every relationship, nor can we get into every exception to the rule. So those are the dimensions of our talk. Now what I want to do is just briefly give you a point of personal disclosure. Okay. Point of personal disclosure. At the risk, at the least, of being misinterpreted, and at the worst, manipulated, okay, I'm going to make a confession. Not to be one of the guys, not to prove my humanity, not to say, wow, what a manly guy John is, that he's being this open, but I live in transparency. I want to be a transparent person. And here's my confession. I personally have to work very diligently to remain sexually pure. It's a process. And by the way, on a number of occasions in my life, I think I've failed. Whether it be big or small, who's to judge what's big, what's small? We're going to look at a scripture where Jesus says, you know, if you even look at a woman with lust in your heart, you've committed adultery against her. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. You know, once I became a Christian, some of you may resonate with this. Once I became a Christian, I wished upon a star that all temptations would just go away, right? Now, you don't have to do show of hands for anything tonight, but I'm just telling you, maybe you can just nod at me like, yeah, I thought I'm going to be a Christian and everything. I thought once I got married to my absolutely wonderful and beautiful wife, Denise, I thought once I got married, man, I'd have no other thoughts, no other desire, no for any other person other than her. That's what I thought. Now, some of you that are married, you go, nope. I mean, don't shake your head too. Don't shake your head a lot. I mean, your spouse is probably right next to you, but. And then I thought, once I became a pastor, well, of course, man, I'm going to lead people into the presence in the throne room of God, that there would never be a sinful thought or a sinful action. All those things would just completely disappear. Now, I know it's possible that some of you are uncomfortable with what I'm doing right now and the way that I'm talking, okay, this kind of disclosure. I mean, really, the level of uncomfortableness probably is greatest for even my wife who's in this room. It could be uncomfortable for religious people. People that would say, hey, sex is bad, it's only for procreation, those kind of people, okay? You may think this topic is taboo, but meanwhile, friends, hear me, lust, sexual addiction, adultery, emotional affairs, porn, masturbation, homosexuality, etc., 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 are, hear me, make no mistake, they are the, not an, they're the silent killers of our generation. Spiritual, marital, I mean, they're just killing people. It's taking people out of the game all over. Think about your own kind of confidence, your own level of confidence when you have failed so habitually in certain areas that you just go, how do I even talk to someone about this? How do I even lift my hands in worship before a God that wants holding me? I mean, you can just look at these areas. And so I don't say all this to elicit a response, but I say this to invite you into a place of transparency where we could look at things that our heart and our lives and our eyes have been exposed to, where we can consider hurt that's been put against us or maybe hurt we've done to others, abuse sexually, physically, when you can think about issues of lust and pornography and others, and begin to look at your own life and say, gosh, if a leader of our church can be that kind of open and transparent, as maybe if you've been around for the last month in our church's life, you've seen, and isn't cute, by the way, I'm not trying to be cute or trendy. I'm just trying to be as open before God as I possibly can and open before people so that you can see what openness looks like. And so I say all that just to invite you into this, that we're not just thinking about something ethereal. We're not just looking at the culture or the world going, world bad. You're thinking bad stuff. No, friends, this has been so permeated in the life of the church. And the church is a hospital. Hospitals gather sick and hurting people, don't they? You know, when we hear a statistic about 50% of the church divorced as a national statistic, that really represents the fact that the church is attracting broken people. That's who's coming to our churches. And so we've got to be open and honest with these things, and it never helps anyone if you just kind of bury it and never talk about it and never come out in the open and bring things into the light. I've said it before, there is no shame in confessed sin. There's no shame, okay? So, the Bible and sexual ethics. Sexual ethics is a governing moral construct. I'm going to give you a governing moral construct, and I'm breaking it up into four parts. I'm calling it a four-part biblical framework. You ready to dive in? This is where we're going to get to work now, okay? The four-part biblical framework for how to approach sexual ethics. And again, ethics is a governing moral construct. Is we're going to look at creation, we're going to look at separation, which is the fall of mankind, we're going to look at redemption, and then just briefly as we finish, we won't spend much time on this at all, we're going to look at glorification, okay? Creation, separation, redemption, and glorification. Let's begin with creation. If you have your notes in front of you, and you may not, I'm going to ask everyone in this room to yell out the three words that are right behind the colon on creation, and you're just going to feel so great about doing this, okay? So, and if you don't know what those three words are, if you don't have a handout, if the three words are sex is good, okay, everyone, one, two, three, yell it.
Sex is good!
The value and the significance, the value and significance of human sexuality is particularly evident in the account of creation. Okay, you look at the creation story and you're going to see the value of human sexuality. Human beings fashioned by God in his own image. Okay, we're in Genesis basically right now. Human beings fashioned by the Lord in his own image created male and female. Okay, now I'm just going to open up my Bible and you, I don't know if you'll have one near you or with you, or, but we're going to trek through the scripture for a bit here. But when I look at the Bible, I discover that in Genesis 1, verse 27, it says God created mankind, humanity, in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. Okay? He's just layering this thing. It's basically saying, hey, God created mankind. Oh, it was in the image of God that he created mankind. And oh, by the way, he created mankind as male and as female. Now, it expounds upon it in chapter 2. When you get into chapter 2, if you were to zoom down to verse 18, chapter 2 is really a magnified version of chapter 1. And it says this, starting verse 18. The Lord God says, it's not good for man to be alone. I'll make a helper suitable for him. Now, the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the wild animals and all the birds in the sky. He brought them to man to see what he would name them. And whenever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds of the sky, and the wild animals. But for Adam, there was no suitable helper to be found. So the Lord caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and then closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woe man from the rib he had taken out of the man, and he brought her to the man. And the man says, this is now bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of the man. And that's why a man leaves his father and mother and is united to his wife, and they become one flesh. Now, verse 25 tells us something great. Adam and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. No shame, okay? What you need to look back at was where in verse 23, where the man said, many people believe that he actually broke out into song, okay? That he wrote a poem, or he put a song with a lyric set to rhythm and set to a cadence and began to sing it to his wife. Now, this is going to be a PG kind of thing, but let me just kind of paint a picture for you. The Bible does a really good job, but I don't need to add much to it. But you've got a naked man, and you've got now a naked woman that he's laying eyes on for the first time. Okay, first time. This guy's just been kind of just working with animals, basically, right? That's all he's really had. And he's naming them. They're all walking by him, and he's thinking, yeah, that's a pretty cool animal, but there was nothing suitable, the scripture says, for him. And so then God formed this woman, all right? And this woman now is naked, he's naked, and this is wonderful. Right there, being brought to him, he begins to sing. He just starts singing, okay? Naked woman, and he starts singing. Now, I think about that when I think about the whole of Scripture. The whole of Scripture declares sex to be good. Okay, there was something good and wonderful about the nudity that they had between one another, and then later the union that they would have with one another. There's so many scriptures that support the beauty of what God has created to be shameless, to be wonderful, to be enjoyed together with one another. Listen, friends, there's so many passages of scriptures. If I were to take you to the literal translation of the Song of Solomon, if we were to get the Hebrew out and begin to look at the Hebrew translations, the New International Version, the English Standard Version, even the King James Version, all took the easy route. They didn't know how to, they knew how to translate it, they just chose not to. Why? Because it was so steamy. So steamy. The kind of image that you find in the Song of Solomon, just as one book, a love song from Solomon to his bride, in the original language, I can make him blush. I just know I could. I mean, he never blushes at this kind of stuff. But I tell you, I can make you blush if I were to get in the original language. Over in Proverbs, Proverbs 5, verse 19, it says, the husband ought to be ravished with his wife's breasts. Now, when I think about whether or not I'm going to be a person who takes the Bible literally, friends, I want to tell you there's a great advantage to taking the Bible literally. It's a great advantage, okay? But did you get that word? Ravished. Ravished. Listen, there is no way you could ever think that the Bible is negative about sex, okay? It's not like it. No. Now, I'm going to point out one verse, that, and we're not in the New Testament yet. We'll get there soon. But there's one verse that perhaps those of you that have been around the Bible enough would maybe push back at me for 1 second. And that is out of 1 Corinthians 7, verse 1, it says, it is not good for a man to have sexual relations with a woman. Okay, but you have to understand something. That is not what it's actually saying. The Apostle Paul was addressing questions that the Corinthian church was bringing to him by letter. And you can see that because at about four times in the book of 1 Corinthians, he responds back by saying, and now about the matter that you wrote about. And then he would put something in quotes. They were asking about spiritual gifts, and he would quote them. Now about the matter about spiritual gifts that you're asking about. And here in this particular one, 1 Corinthians 7, 1, now for the matter that you wrote about, quote, it is good for a man not to have sexual relations with a woman, end quote. If you just took that one verse, you'd go, God's against sex. But that's not right, because Paul then follows it up and saying, no, that's not the best view. You see, the Corinthian church felt like they were godly people, and because they were so godly, they thought, well, God must not want us to have anything carnal or anything fleshly or anything pleasurable. That must be how we're gonna grow best in the Lord. And Paul's saying, no. He then gave them some parameters, and I'll get into those parameters later, but I want you to understand, if you were thinking 1 Corinthians 7 is against sex, it is not. It is a misquote and a mistranslation of the scripture, okay? Sex and sexual differences between men and women were pronounced very good by God in Genesis 1:31. Very good. Okay, so we believe sexuality is a wonderful gift from God. Someone should say amen right now. Okay. One, however, that is intended to function best and properly within covenant. Sorry, within covenant. Now we talked about covenant. But by the way, friends, biblical sex is a covenant act. It's not a consumer good. Okay, it's not a consumer good. Culture has made it to be a consumer good. Something you just kind of give. Something you ask for. If you really love me, you're going to give this to me. If you really love me, you're going to give this to me. I heard a story just recently by a pastoral friend of mine that was talking up to me about one of his pastoral staff, a female. And this pastoral staff had been out on a date. She's single and she'd been out on a date. And this individual came back and they asked, well, how'd the date go? And she said, it went horrible. He, right from the very beginning, as a Christian man, said to me, hey, listen, if we're not going to have sex, I'm just going to call this thing off now. So here were two Christians, this man saying, if we're not going to have sex, if you don't give me sex, let's not continue in this thing. So you have to ask yourself, what would a non-Christian look like? And this poor girl was so discouraged, thinking, oh, man, who's out there? And we know there's a lot of great men and a lot of great women. This is not the case with everybody. But if we view sex as a consumer good rather than a covenant act, we are missing the scripture. All sexual relations outside of marriage are condemned in scripture. Now, condemned sounds like a horrible word, but that's the word we need to use. Okay? Any sex outside of marriage is inappropriate for disciples of Jesus Christ. Now, I'm assuming something, that I'm talking primarily to believers in this room, okay? Believers. Now, there may be some unbelievers, but this is not how I would talk to you, okay? But to believers, if you're a disciple of Jesus Christ, you have to understand the Bible holds a standard for us, and that is sex outside of marriage, outside the covenant of marriage, is not appropriate. It is condemned. I could use the word discouraged, but it sounds so weak, right? How many feel a little bit different when you say the word condemned, right? It doesn't mean condemned to hell, That's what we oftentimes do in our mind. We put the words to hell right behind the word condemned. We've got to stop doing that, okay? And this is what brings us now to this second part of the biblical framework. It brings us to the fall. It brings us to the separation after creation. And this is where sex became complicated, right? Isn't that a Facebook thing? I'm not on Facebook right now. I don't do a lot on it, but can't you put on the relationship status? Could you put complicated, right? You know, sex is complicated. And here's where you have Adam and Eve disobeying the Lord in the garden, and it led not only to a point of real separation from God and ultimate death, but it also alienated human beings from one another. And it started to distort the sexual relationships that can be had in wholesomeness and in covenant between a man and between a woman. Here's what Genesis 3, verse 7 says. It says, "Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked." Right? They were naked as jaybirds, right? So here's what they did. They sewed fig leaves together, and they made coverings for themselves. Immediately after the fall of mankind, they felt bad. They felt horrible. They felt shame-filled. And it says later on, a couple verses later, they began to hide from God. Now, the Bible gives us a number of examples of this kind of separation, this kind of confusion that kicked in almost within the next 4 to 6 pages. If you were to go a little bit further, what are you going to start seeing? You're going to start seeing guys sleeping with their daughters. You're going to start seeing adultery. You're going to start seeing, obviously, murders. You're going to start seeing just a whole series of sinful things start to just unravel. Humanity starts to unravel, okay? And what I want to do is I want to show you what the Bible gives us in terms of confusion sexually and points of separation. And I'm going to use a passage of Scripture. I'm going to use Galatians 5:19. You may just want to write that out in the corner. And I'm going to give it to you out of the King James Version. And there's a reason, because I'm going to go a little bit old school in terms of the words that we use. Okay? Galatians 5:19 tells us, "The acts of the flesh are obvious." Now, in the King James, actually says manifest. Other versions will say evident. "The acts of the flesh are evident, they're obvious, they're manifest." And here is a list. And I'm only going to look at the first four, because the first four of this list of the acts of the flesh are the four that I want to focus on this evening, okay? And the first one is adultery. I think that's right, yeah. Adultery. And we'll get to the next few in just a second, because these words are important for us to talk about. Four sexual sin categories, if you will. Four categories. Does this include everything of sexual sin? I hadn't thought about that question, actually, until I just said it. I think they do. I think they do. And I'll show you why in a second. Will we keep creating things? Yeah, the craziness gets created all the time. And we're going to see that in a passage in Romans. But I think these will capture all of what we could call the sin categories when it comes to sexual sin. Let's talk first about adultery. And I'm going to spend the least amount of time on this one, because there's other areas that we need to talk a little bit more on. Adultery is this. It is the unlawful, biblically unlawful, sexual intercourse involving at least one married person. Okay, that's kind of the technical definition. Adultery, plainly put, it violates God's original purpose for marriage. Now, again, remember we said we're going to deal with this compassionately, okay? Because in this room, I don't know all of your stories, but I can tell you this exists more than likely in this room, okay? It violates God's original and whole purpose for our lives and for our marriage. Now, Jesus tells us something in Matthew, and I wish I could go to every verse about adultery, but I can't. Adultery first gets addressed in Deuteronomy, the law of Moses, and Moses made some allowances for people. He made allowances for those, particularly women. And whenever we think that the Bible somehow is putting down women or somehow lowering them, boy, you need to look closer, because the law of Moses actually was elevating, and then Jesus again was elevating women even further, those that were particularly trapped with men that wouldn't release them, but were either neglectful, they were committing adulterous affairs, they would divorce, all this stuff. Divorce was given some parameters in the Old Testament, and then Jesus follows it up a little bit further. And he says this in Matthew 5. It says, "You have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery." I'm sorry, let me make sure I'm in the right passage here. Let me go down actually to verse 31. And we're going to go back and look at the verses prior to that in a little bit. "It's been said, anyone who divorces his wife must give her a certificate of divorce. But I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except for sexual immorality, makes her the victim of adultery. And anyone who marries a divorced woman commits adultery." Now, that sounds very hard, and it is. There's a lot of things you have to wrestle with in there. But you have to understand, culturally, Jesus was elevating women by giving them reasons for an allowance of divorce so that they were free from some marriages that were very, very oppressive. And I can't go too deeply in this, but I want to tell you that I've got something, if this interests you, and I got enough copies for maybe 30 of you, but I've got well, it's about 20 pages. Let me look here. 23 pages. A 23-page paper on divorce and remarriage, looking at, as much as I was able to, the scriptural examination of divorce and remarriage. Now, I may appeal to some of you to look at that, but I want to show you how, in this paper, there is hope. Okay, I want to speak hope to you. That if there's been adultery in your past or if there's been divorce in your past, there is hope according to Scripture, all right? Some have felt very, very oppressed in this, even in the coming into a church. I can remember talking with one person who was divorced through adultery and walked in the church and said, "I think God might possibly strike me dead as I'm walking in here." And I was able to say, "Why?" And they explained their story. And I was like, "No, God's not going to strike you dead. Please come in, receive grace." And this is a grace-filled paper, but it examines all of the passages about divorce, remarriage, and adultery. So you can grab that if that helps you. The second category that I want to look at, again, I told you I was going to look at adultery for a very brief amount of time because I want to talk now about fornication. Everyone say fornication? Fornication. Old school word. We don't use it anymore, do we? It's a lot like adultery. We've gotten so used to calling it an affair that we've forgotten what the biblical word really is adultery. We don't want to call it that. It's too heavy. Friends, this word fornication is the word that we have in the old language for sexual immorality. Okay, sexual immorality. And both, we use sexual immorality, use fornication. They're pretty strong either way, but how many know fornication just sounds a little scarier, right? Fornication. Now, this is the word in the Greek for the word pornia. Pornia, P-O-R-N-I-A. It's the Greek word, and it's used 55 times in the New Testament. Okay, sexual immorality, pornia, fornication. And what it includes, but isn't limited to, but it includes lust, it includes pornography, it includes illicit sex, including prostitution, includes incest. Promiscuity is a lack of moral restraint sexually. It includes sex outside of marriage, okay? It really fornication is really a catch-all, if you will, of a lot of things that are outside the bounds of what God has designed us to function as, sexual and yet spiritual beings. Let me give you a few scriptures. I think I've included them in your notes out of 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians 5:1, it says, "It is reported commonly that there is fornication among you, and such fornication is not so much as named among the Gentiles." He's basically saying, listen, you are Jews, you are God's chosen people. Friends, you are Christians, you are God's people. He's saying, we don't even talk about this over with the Gentiles, but now you've got it reported among you. And I think we could say the same about the church. How many understand fornication is happening in the world a lot, okay? People are fornicating right now as we speak, right? Okay? But here's what the problem is we're seeing this just sweeping the church. It's affecting leaders. It's affecting key people. It's affecting pastors. It's affecting Christians, followers of Jesus Christ, that it's being reported very common among Jesus' people. 1 Corinthians 6:13 says, "Now the body, our body, is not for fornication, but it's for the Lord, and the Lord is for the body." 1 Corinthians 6:18. Flee fornication, flee sexual immorality. Every sin that a man does is outside the body. But he that commits fornication sins against his own body. 1 Corinthians 7:2. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife and every woman have her own husband. Okay, so that's fornication. All right. Let me take you to a third category. Uncleanness. Uncleanness. Now, this is an interesting word for what we're talking about. It often refers to, by the way, the physical acts of homosexuality and lesbianism. Okay, this word uncleanness. Now, this is where I want to be careful and yet clear, okay? Can we do that? I'm going to be careful, but I'm going to be clear. I believe the Bible. Notice I didn't say I believe. I'm adding the phrase the Bible. I believe the Bible calls homosexuality a sin. Okay, I'm not looking for full approval on that. Some may disagree. But I believe the Bible calls homosexuality sin. Those that practice homosexuality can be called to repentance, as can anyone. With any sexual preference, sexual identity, or frankly, any other sin. Okay, when you read of these lists in the scripture, by the way, this one out of Galatians 6 has these four terms, adultery, fornication, and uncleanness. We're going to get to the last one in a second. When we go further into Galatians 6, there's a bunch of other things. These are the acts of the flesh, and there's a whole bunch of them. And we could spend time talking about those things, but tonight is about a sexual ethic, so we're looking just at these four. But frankly, any sin is one that we need to repent of, okay? And so that's why I want us to look at the scriptures that delve into this topic of uncleanness, okay? Uncleanness. And that is particularly referencing homosexuality and lesbian. And there's one case where lesbianism really comes into play. But let me just give you a quick little disclaimer. Despite what you may have been led to believe, particularly in fundamental circles, fundamentalism, heavy legalistic circles, the Bible does not reference homosexuality on every page. Okay? Sometimes when the world hears Christians talk, it's as if every page you turn has got something about condemning homosexuality, right? That's not true. It doesn't have that many references. There's approximately 9 clear references to homosexuality. And now we have to be also open to the reality that there's various references to shrine prostitution in the scripture, which undoubtedly would have involved male homosexuality, okay? Undoubtedly. We know from history, we know from historical documents that it would have included that. But we have around 9 very clear references to this in the scripture. The Bible, by the way, addresses many other topics with greater frequency, okay? With greater frequency. But that doesn't diminish God's command, okay? Because, example, shouldn't we just be told once and then we should do it? Right? How many times do we have to be told this is the parent to me coming out, right? How many times do we have to tell our kids to do something or to not do something for it to be what we want them to do or not do? Do we have to do that with regularity? Does that have to happen every day? Every few minutes do we have to tell them to where they finally go, oh, I now know you're serious about this? No. By the way, God only needs to say something once for it to become what he is asking of us to do or not to do. The reason I bring up the frequency of homosexuality in the scriptures is because I want us to understand that if the global church would hammer on economic injustice the way it's perceived to hammer on sexual issues, I think we would have a lot more credibility in the general public. Because the Bible speaks over and over and over about economic injustice, about our lack of care for the poor, okay? But I say that to not somehow give us a pass. And by the way, that pass is being used a lot in our culture. People that will critique Christians and their views regarding sexuality will say, well, listen, man, what are you making a big deal about? The Bible only talks about it a few times, but it talks about this a whole bunch. It talks, the classic argument is homosexuality versus gluttony. You know what I'm saying? Everyone goes, well, talks about this a lot. Why aren't you talking about that more in the local church? And here's my answer. We should be talking about that more. We should be talking about a lot of things more. Okay? And this is one topic that the church has to be clear about, but we can't make it everything that we talk about. All right? So I've got a little disclaimer out there. Now let's jump into a handful of scriptures. We're not going to jump into all 9 of them, but we're going to look at some of the biggies. Starting with this, Genesis 19. Genesis 19, verses 1 through 29. I will not read the story because the story is fairly familiar. How many are familiar with, if not the story, you're familiar with the cities of Sodom and what? Gomorrah. Okay, I wanted to see, that was a test to see if you even knew what I was talking about. Sodom and Gomorrah. We know according to the story that two angelic beings came into the city and wanted to stay at Lot's house. And we believe that they were very visibly, they gave the visible look of being men, okay? So men, but they end up being angels. Two angels came and stayed at his house. Verse 5 says that men from the city, a large mob or crowd of men, came and surrounded Lot's house, called out to Lot, and he said this, where are the men? I emphasize that because they perceived there were men as well. Okay, where are the men who came to you tonight? Bring them out to us so that we can have sex with them. Okay, that is what's happening in Genesis 19. Now, they weren't allowed out. The story goes on. They end up running. The angels told them to leave. You've got the story of them leaving the city. You've got Lot's wife that turns around. She turns into a pillar of salt. Everyone with me on this story so far? Okay, that's the story. Now, Jude, then the last book before the book of Revelation, Jude verse 7, it only gives us verses because it's only one chapter. So Jude 7 says this, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities, which in the same manner as they indulged in sexual immorality and went after other flesh. Now, many commentators believe that the phrase other flesh refers to angelic flesh or flesh of another kind. That somehow they knew that they were angels and they wanted to see what it would be like to have sexual encounter with these angelic beings, okay? Now, that's not very clear in the text, okay? All we are told just at face value is that these were known to be men, known to be men. Now, here we have another passage of scripture I got to take you to. Ezekiel, rather, 16, verse 49. You can write that down and look at it later if you'd like. Here's what Ezekiel 16, verse 49 says. This was the guilt of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters had pride, excess of food, and prosperous ease, and they did not aid the poor and the needy. Now, I bring that up because sometimes as we're thinking through a sexual ethic of what we believe about these things, in particular, right now we're talking about homosexuality, is others outside of our camp, outside of our tribe, would say to us, hey, no, Ezekiel 16 tells us that the real sin of Sodom was they were inhospitable. They didn't care for the poor. They were prideful. That their real sin was not sexuality or homosexuality in particular. Now, what I want to take you back to, and we're just going to work in reverse now, is again what Jude 7 says. Okay, Jude 7 says, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding cities indulged in sexual immorality, fornication, including, it's a catch-all for all kinds of things outside of the will of God for our sexuality, okay? And they also had pride, inhospitality, and unconcern for the poor. So here's what I want to show you out of Genesis chapter 19. Yes, you can conclude that one of many sins that existed within Sodom and Gomorrah was homosexuality. But what you can't do is make an airtight case that the reason why God, now hear me closely, that the reason why God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah was because of the homosexuals. What that is akin to the, I think, inerrant theology that exists within groups throughout our nation. The most obviously famous one is out of Texas. If you ever wanted to find their website, it's real easy. It's GodHatesFags.com. And they go from city to city. They've been here in Salem. They've protested here at some of our local churches. And we see in that thinking, this idea that God destroyed Sodom because of the homosexuals. And that is not the reason he destroyed them. It is one of various reasons. Okay? The hardness of their hearts was probably the primary one. The sin of hatred, the sin of violence, the sin of pride. And by the way, what's interesting about that, and I don't know if you'll agree with me entirely on this, I think what's interesting is when you see groups that call themselves Christians and yet lash out at other people groups with such venom, it can be said, I think, in my opinion, that the same sins that they say are resident within these other people's lives are actually resident within themselves. So does God have a gradient of sin? Does he look and say, this is the reason why I destroyed Sodom, and this is the reason why I'm going to bless you because you hate these people? No, God, I think, has a doctrine and a heart and a motive of love for all people and wants us to reach and continually disciple people, but we can't do it by matching it with the same level of hatred, pride, violence. It's just a different manifestation of brokenness. And so we want to be careful that we don't use Genesis 19 as a hammer to beat people up, but you can, I think, agree that there was homosexuality taking place within Sodom and Gomorrah. Let's move to the next one. Leviticus 18. Now it's getting good. Here we go. Leviticus 18. You may want to look at this. It's verse 22. The Bible says Leviticus 18, one of the most well-known verses, I think, in most of Christianity. It says, do not have sexual relations with a man as one does with a woman. That is detestable. Okay, I'm going to take you one chapter or two chapters over. Chapter 20 is verse 13. And this now he lays out the punishments. This is the law, the Levitical law. He lays out the punishments. If a man has sexual relations with a man, as one does with a woman, both of them have done what is detestable. It sounds just like what we just read, right? But now he's going to add something. This is interesting. This is the Bible, though. They are to be put to death. Their blood will be on their own heads. Ouch. Wow. Okay. So what do we have here? Well, we have a couple verses that are unambiguous. What does that mean? They're clear. I don't need to look at them in the Hebrew. I mean, this says, if you do this, it is detestable. If this is what's happening, there is a price. There is a penalty. Now, people will often wonder, and this is where we need to talk for a little bit. People often wonder, is there a difference between ceremonial law and moral law? Okay, ceremonial law versus moral law. In other words, the things that you're supposed to do to get ready for the ritual, like the way you bathe, the clothing you put on, the kind of laws about touching blood and those kinds of things that we read throughout the book of Leviticus. Okay, is there a difference between the ritual law and the moral law? Here's what you oftentimes hear from people that particularly want to spar with you about this topic. They'll say, well, then why then, if God is opposed to homosexuality so bad, then why is it that you're wearing clothes with two mixed fibers, Katie? Why? Busted. Everyone knows your name, right? Put her to death. No, well, number one, the individuals that were wearing mixed fibers weren't put to death. But secondly, we have to understand something about the Old Testament. The Old Testament doesn't make a systematic distinction between what is ritual and what is moral law. Okay, the same section of what we call the holiness code, that's what we've been reading here, the same section of the holiness code has prohibitions against incest. Is that ritual or moral? Says who? Yeah. Okay. But you see the debate. So, do we want to debate about mixed fibers? Do we want to debate about incest? Do we want to debate about, there's a whole list of things. And many of them are very vivid, very graphic. A lot of things has to do with sexual relationships with their spouse and when that can happen and certain processes that takes place and how you clean up and all that kind of stuff. Do we want to get into all the areas of what is ritual or what is moral? We have to be careful about reading the Bible and picking and choosing what we want and what we don't want. And both sides of the camp have to do the same thing. So we as Christians that hold to the Bible as the inerrant, infallible word of God, we have to be careful that we're not picking and choosing. And the same side, on the other side, they can't just go, well, I like this, but I don't like this. And to help you in this process, there's a book that I want you to maybe circle on your resource list. It's probably the best thing I've read about this, and it's called Slaves, Women, and Homosexuals. It's a very thick, weighty, meaty book. Slaves, Women, and Homosexuals. And what you will see throughout this book is, and he has no dog in this fight. This individual who wrote this has no dog in this fight. He will walk through a hermeneutic. If you understand that word, a hermeneutic is a way of researching the Bible that is consistent throughout the Bible. In other words, you don't change your hermeneutic for what you don't like. You don't find a new way to interpret the scripture and go, well, that must be allegorical. That's more of a poem there. No, you can't just kind of create a new criteria for whatever it is you don't like. So this person has a consistent hermeneutic that goes all the way through, and what it has discovered, I'll give you the cheater version of this book. What is discovered is that where the scriptures talk about slaves from the Old Testament to the New Testament, you only see a release, an openness, an increase of value, expression But when you look at slavery as a topic and slaves as individuals from Old Testament to New Testament, their liberty only gets greater. That's what I'm saying. When you look at women from the Old Testament to the New Testament, this is a big debate. When you look at women and the oppression women have felt over the years, you will only see, not just in current culture, not just in today's culture, but in biblical culture, you will only see greater liberty and release of women from where they were culturally in the days of the Old Testament to moving into the ministry of Jesus to the early church. It only goes up in terms of liberty. That is, if you follow the same hermeneutic, the same way of studying and researching the Bible, that is not the case for homosexuality, biblically. Okay, the constraint, the prohibition, which is against, is what that means, only stays the same, if not gets more stringent into the New Testament. Okay, so that's what that book is about, and I want you to maybe consider either looking at it, or we can talk a little bit further about that. But that's how we can approach this Old Testament view of the moral law versus the ritual law, okay? But now let's jump to the New Testament, okay? Remember, we're still talking about uncleanness right now. Everyone with me so far? How are we doing? We doing good? Okay, we're just going to go a little bit longer here. Let's go to the New Testament. 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 and 10, if you got your Bibles. 1 Corinthians, this is an important one for us to look at. 1 Corinthians 6. Let me tell you a few things as you're looking at your Bibles for 1 Corinthians 6. I'll tell you a few things about Corinth. The city of Corinth, I've been to it. It's a port town. It's a very perverted culture. And they have extensive pride for their sexual activity. If you could picture Corinth as being like the San Francisco of our day, okay? Okay, very perverse and very prideful about their sexual activity. There was, historically, we know from writers and from historians, we know there was sexual and gender confusion. In and around the temple, there were many people believe there were over 1,000 prostitutes that engaged in temple worship, quote-unquote worship. They had strippers. There was open marriage, bisexuality in Corinth. Matter of fact, perverts were called Corinthians. That's what you called perverts during that time. You're a Corinthian. And if you were prostitute, a female prostitute, you were called a Corinth girl. A Corinth girl. That was just the title. It was so bad there. STDs were rampant in Corinth. There was no medical care, by the way, that was really helpful in the areas of STDs. But what they did was they had these shrines set up, and the shrines were in the shape of genitalia, okay? Large shrines. And what they believed is if they would go stand in front of them, they would be healed of their sexually transmitted diseases, okay? So this is how gross and perverse this culture was. So now it comes to 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 and 10. Here's what it says. Do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor the idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And that is what some of you were. Okay, we're going to get to that verse, verse 11, in just a little bit. That's what some of you were. We'll talk about that in a bit. But in this passage, we have this phrase, men that have sex with men. Now, here's how you should translate this. It's best translated in the King James. In the King James, it's we read in our more modern versions, men that have sex with men. In the King James, it refers to effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind. Now, that's a lot of stuff there. And to complicate it even further, I'm going to give you some Greek words, okay? Some Greek words that will help you on this whole thing. When you look at the word effeminate in the King James, you have this word in the Greek. It is M-A-L-A-K-O-I, malakoi, okay? But when you get to the phrase abusers of themselves with mankind, you have a whole other word, and it's the word arsenokate. Okay. Other versions of the Bible will say male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders. That's other versions of the Bible, okay? It refers to this as a prostitute, which is this Greek word right here, and it means soft or effeminate, or soft, effeminate young boys, okay? This word down here is the Greek, and it means one who has intercourse with males, or more specifically, young males. Now, stay with me. Don't turn here, but I'm going to read you another list out of 1 Timothy. Okay, this is still Paul. Paul's still talking, and here's what he says in 1 Timothy 1, verses 9 through 11. He says, we know that the law is made not for the righteous, but for the lawbreakers and rebels, the ungodly, the sinful, the unholy, the irreligious, for those who kill their fathers or mothers, for murderers, for the sexually immoral, for those practicing homosexuality, for slave traders, there's that idea of slavery again, liars, perjurers, for whatever else is contrary to sound doctrine. Okay, I'm going to stop right there. Those practicing homosexuality in this verse, those practicing homosexuality is this word in 1 Timothy, so we see it again. Now, let me take you back to Leviticus 18. I know we're going deep, but stick with me here. Leviticus 18, when you read it from what's called the Septuagint is the Greek translation of the Hebrew text. It says, whoever lies with a man as with a woman, they have both done an abomination. Now, lies with a man as with a woman. I'm not going to write it out, but it's in Greek, and it's a translation of the Hebrew, and it is meta arsenos o koitin gymkatia, and you have both these words are found in here. This, what we believe is this, that some of the few times that you find this in the entirety of Scripture, Paul is making reference to this abusers of themselves, these that have intercourse with men, those that practice homosexuality, that it is the same prohibition that you find in Leviticus chapter 18. Here's why I tell you all this. It's because it appears as if, and this is a common thing, when you're building a sexual ethic in your mind, a common thing people say is, well, the New Testament, this dispensation of grace, it rules out anything from the Old Testament. You've got to throw Leviticus 18 out. That's not true. Jesus didn't come to abolish the law. He came to fulfill the law, right? Okay, so it appears as if the New Testament is consistent completely with the Old Testament teaching on homosexuality. Paul affirms this. As a matter of fact, everywhere in the New Testament where homosexuality and sexual immorality is mentioned, there is often a list of other sins, okay? And what you have to know is none of the other sins have been negated. So if there's other sins on there, You don't ever look at that list and go, oh man, well, we don't do this. You know, this one we don't hold to anymore. We let that one go. No, everyone still condemns, but, you know, as a culture, we still condemn all the other sins. isn't it interesting that in all the lists regarding homosexuality, that is the only thing that culturally we have said, that's good, let's go for it. We don't say that with incest. We don't need to show hands here, but I think we all agree, incest, bad, right? Okay, there's a lot of things. I mean, right down to dishonoring your parents and like the one list here about murdering your parents. This is the kinds of stuff that we look at and go, duh, we don't do that. We culturally agree. This is the only one that we have created a battle over, okay? And this is where I want to take you to the last scripture, and this is a doozy. Romans chapter 1, Romans 1, a very common one. Again, we're building a sexual ethic in a day and age when this is a big, big topic. And I want to look at you with you in the New King James Version, okay? This is the most crucial text because this is the theology behind the prohibition of homosexuality and, by the way, lesbianism, okay? Which I know homosexuality is a large kind of grouping over that all, but it gets real specific. Therefore, it says, God also gave them up to uncleanliness. That's that word we saw. And in the lusts of their heart, to dishonor their body amongst themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie, and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. For this reason, God gave them up to vile passions. Even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise, also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful, and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error, which was due. Okay, in Romans, the Apostle Paul condemns the practice of homosexuality in the severest of ways. Okay, it's actually labeled contrary to nature. And I know this doesn't play well in the culture. That's why we're talking in here. Okay? In other words, nature itself, and I think if we had to do a show of hands and a nod of our head, we'd go, nature itself teaches or shows intuitively that the practice is wrong. Just nature itself. You just kind of go, that part don't fit with that other part. You know what I'm saying? We just see that, okay? And I don't want to make light of that, but that's just, I mean, nature itself, it just says, this doesn't seem to work. Okay, now Romans is a very strong commentary against homosexuality. But I want you to understand something. Paul singles that particular sin out not because it's more wrong than any other sin or any other point of unrighteousness, okay, like disrespect for parents, okay? He singles it out because it's the most obvious reflection of this graphic way in which we've exchanged the truth of God for a lie. It's like we've flipped it. We've reversed it. We've distorted it. We went, hey, God, your truth, but now I'm not believing you. I'm believing in a lie. It's like we've taken the very natural thing to obey God and said, no, I'm not going to do that anymore. The bottom line that we see in the book of Romans, and the bottom line really, according to the whole scripture, is, and I'm sorry if this offends, but it is the truth of the scripture, I believe, as I interpret the Bible, is homosexuality is a sin. Now, we're supposed to hate all sin and not just the big ones. Okay, church, not just the big ones. If you have one speck of dirt on you, you're still unclean. 1 Thessalonians 4:7, it says, God did not call us to be unclean, but to be holy. Verse 3, he says, it's God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that's holy and honorable, not in passionate lust like the pagans who do not know God. Okay, and this is an issue that's becoming very polarized in our culture and polarizing in our churches. On Friday, I'll drive to another city and sit and film a resource for our Foursquare churches across the nation, not the world, but the nation, about our stance regarding LGBTQ issues. And the reason they asked me is because I sat in a meeting with 20 pastors, and it was 2 days of long debate that was going nowhere. This is a topic that has really got people confused, even pastors. I sat with a college president today, a local college, Christian college today, and says, I said, what's the number one thing you're facing? What can I pray for you about? He says, we are facing this issue regarding LGBTQ issues and the effect it's going to have on us with legal ramifications in a very profound way. Thanks be to God, we haven't experienced it yet, but that day probably is coming where we've got to have an answer. And in these 2 days of meetings, the reason they asked me to film something is because I spent about 3 hours in the middle of the night, could not sleep, seeking the Lord about what this means, not just for us at West Salem Forest Square Church, but what does it mean for us as Christians? And I realized something that I feel like the Lord gave me. It's the reason why they want me to come film something this week, is I believe we should clearly articulate what our stand is, not our stand about LGBTQ issues, because those will change. Something new will come along. Something's always going to come down the pike, friends. How long have we lived where something always just keeps coming down? What was the hot issue years ago? What was it a few years after that? I mean, we can see culturally where things get flared up. This happens to be the big issue. And I realize we don't need to articulate our views necessarily on LGBTQ issues. We need to articulate these three things. And if you hear anything I say tonight, this is what I would want to capture. We have to articulate the Lordship of Jesus Christ. The Lordship of Jesus Christ. If he's not your Lord, then we can't even really get into sexual discussions. We have to talk first, is he your Lord? Secondly, the inerrancy and the authority of Scripture. And the reason why this is profound, I think, and the reason why I'm going to be filmed to talk about this is because we believe that's a waning thing even within our very conservative Foursquare denomination. That there are individuals around us serving as my peers that are not quite convinced of the inerrancy and the authority of Scripture. And that could alarm some of you, but that's the culture we're living in, and that's what we have to affirm. And thirdly, we would affirm repentance and restoration through the cross. Through the cross. Now, I could take forever just to kind of go through each one of those and talk about them, but we don't have time, and so I want to finish here. Very, very soon. Oh, the last category. The last category is a crazy word, okay? It's what we read in the King James language, and it's lasciviousness. I know you're dying to say that word. Just say it out loud. Go ahead. That's what I thought it would sound like. Lasciviousness, okay? Also called lewdness, also called debauchery. Unashamed indecency, unbridled lust, unrestrained depravity. In today's culture, we could see where this could easily be some descriptive words for all things that are just starting to flood us. And many parents are really deeply concerned about the things I'm about ready to bring up. It could easily be a covering for what we see when we flip through the televisions, what we see on reality TV, what we hear in the music that's being coming across the airwaves. It is probably a great way to define what we're seeing in terms of sexting, the passing back and forth of graphic words and pictures. Miley Cyrus made the word twerking pretty big. The grinding, oral sex, which, by the way, newspaper writer has called oral sex the new goodnight kiss. Most young people are now offering that instead of a goodnight kiss. Voyeurism, public masturbation, swingers. Did you know? I know this. You may not have known it. I'm going to tell you. Don't go look for this, but I'm telling you that there's a such thing now as called Christian swingers. It's a group of what they profess to be Christians that believe they can have an open marriage and they can just start to network with other people to have open sexual relationships. Listen, friends, this is the kind of stuff that is lasciviousness. It's lewdness. It's debauchery. And it's not how we as God's people are to live. Okay, creation, the fall, now redemption. Okay, we're going to move quickly through this. Redemption. Sex can be restored. If you remember that long list we talked about in 1 Corinthians 6, verse 11 says, and I alluded to it, says, that's what some of you were. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. Friends, I can tell you, and this is great hope for many of you in this room that have walked through things, there is forgiveness, there is freedom from sexual sin. There is. There is. And we have to communicate that to people that we're with, okay? Sexual sins are not harder for the Lord to forgive than any other sin. But here's what they are, and I want to be clear about this. They are more damaging. They're more damaging at a personal level and at a social dimension, okay? They affect things. When there's adultery, it affects people. It affects close friends that don't know how to respond or how to act around you or the other couple. When there is exposed pornography in a marriage, prostitution and strip clubs and those, it has massive damage. And in your handout, I've given you a list that you can look on your own time. We won't look at it together. But I highly respect Pastor Jack Hayford. And he wrote and he recorded a tape that I've listened to a number of times. It's called Why Sex Sins Are Worse Than Others. And that's a provocative title. You go, worse than others? Yes, he's basically saying the damages of sex sins are worse. They're greater damage. Proverbs 6 says, can a man scoop fire onto his lap without his clothes being burned? Can a man walk on hot coals without his feet being scorched? So is he who sleeps with another man's wife. Okay? You will get burned. You will. And this may just be a caution for somebody. If you're in a flirtatious environment or if you find yourself in an emotional attachment with someone who's not your spouse, man, stop. Stop. You can't keep scooping that onto your lap without getting burned. Sex is an act of uniting one person to another. If you can imagine two people being super glued together, okay, super glue you together. Now try to disconnect that. There's going to be pain. It's going to tear. It's going to rip. The damage that happens is huge. So there's more damage. But secondly, it's more difficult to find freedom than others. And I want to just articulate this a little bit because I don't ever want to communicate there's no hope for you if you have walked through something sexually. But it is more difficult to find freedom, okay? Lust is never satisfied. What begins with a lingering look now becomes flirtation, moves into magazines, it moves into internet porn. By the way, did you know the top search on the internet is the word sex? Top search in the world. There are 68 million daily searches for porn on the internet. 68 million. 13,000 adult videos are produced annually. That's one every 39 minutes. Over $13 billion are profited through porn. Here's a comparison. Hollywood released 507 movies and made $8.8 billion. Okay, porn makes $13 billion and produces one every 39 minutes. Porn makes more, catch this will blow your mind, porn makes more than the NFL, NBA, and Major League Baseball combined. It makes more than NBC, CBS, and ABC combined in terms of profit. Okay? You can't tell me people aren't looking at porn. And you can't tell me Christians aren't looking at porn. They are looking at porn. Sexting. The largest consumer group of internet pornography is boys between the age of 12 and 17. And that's how they're learning how to just pass photos back and forth between people. Hooking up, adultery, strip clubs. There are 4,000 strip clubs in America. This you may know, you may have heard this. The city with the most strip clubs per 200,000 residents, okay? So take 200,000 residents per 200,000 residents. The city with the most strip clubs, you may have heard, is Portland, right? Okay? Now, per 100,000 residents, it is Springfield, Oregon. Largest per capita of strip clubs in America. Oregon, the state of Oregon, has the most strip clubs per capita. We beat out Nevada. We beat out New Jersey. I'm telling you, we've got exposure to a lot of things in our culture within our region. So where does this stop? I mean, where does this, how do you recover from this? How do you get restored? Where's the redemption if there's no line? I read this recently, 2 Samuel 13:2 says that Amon is A-M-N-O-N. He's a gentleman in the Bible. It says he became so obsessed with his sister Tamar that it made him ill. In other words, here was his sister. He wanted his sister so bad, he was making himself physically ill. That's the level of depravity it got to for this one guy. So what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? And this is where we come to Jesus' words. It's in Matthew 5. In Matthew 5, Jesus' words, he says it very clearly, and we alluded to it earlier, but he says, you have heard it said, you shall not commit adultery. But I tell you, anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. I heard it once said that if you look upon ham and eggs with lust, you've already committed breakfast in your heart, right? How many of you grew up in the era with Jimmy Carter? Remember when Jimmy Carter, he had an interview? Strangely, he's a Christian, he's a godly man, but he had an interview with Playboy magazine, and he admitted to having lust in his heart for multiple women other than his wife. And they just took it and they ran with it. But what he was saying is, he's saying this scripture. He's saying, he actually was quoted as saying, I've committed adultery, because he was referring to this passage of scripture saying, yes, I've lusted after a number of people. That must mean I've committed adultery in my heart. He was trying to be biblical, but he wasn't thinking about what he was saying. And the Bible goes on, Jesus' words, if your right eye causes you to stumble, gouge it out, throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. And if your right hand causes you to stumble, cut it off, throw it away. It's better for you to lose one part of your body than for your whole body to go into hell. Okay, here's the bottom line. I think what Jesus is getting at is we've got to get vigilant with stuff like this. We've got to get to a place, and I want to talk to maybe guys in particular now, not that it would alienate women, but to get to a place where we look each other in the eye, where men look at each other in the eye, and we can say more than I understand. You know, if someone confesses something, that we'd say more than just an empathetic word, that we wouldn't just look at someone and go, man, I understand. I get it, man. There's no sin that's uncommon to men, man. We're all in this together. I get it. I want us, particularly as men, I think this works for gals too, to get to a place where there's still empathy, where we still are saying to people, I understand, but we're moving this down the court a little bit to where we're saying, I am overcoming. Okay, we're moving beyond empathy. Don't lose empathy, but we're moving now to victory. Wouldn't it be great if hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of men within our congregation were able to look each other in the eye and go, man, I'm finding victory in this area. And let me help you find victory as well. Because we got to get beyond just empathy for one another. Like, I get it, man, punching the shoulder. You know, yeah, looking at porn again, I know. I struggle too. Okay, and I'm not saying we're perfect. I'm saying that we would get to a place where we say, no, here's how to overcome. Here's how to get to a point of victory in the spirit rather than in the flesh. Okay, back to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 15. Our bodies are members of Christ himself. Verse 19 of chapter 6, we are temples of the Holy Spirit. 1 Corinthians 6:20, we were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. 1 Corinthians 7:17, each person should live as a believer in whatever situation the Lord has assigned him to, just as God has called you. And that was coming right off of a long discussion by Paul about sexuality and about marriage and about singleness. He's saying, you should all live as believers. I wonder what that would look like if more people lived like believers. And we don't need to expect that from the world, but I think we can have judgment begin in the house of God with us. So whether you're married, whether you're single, okay, I think we're called to live as believers. I just want to address singles just for a second. This isn't just an afterthought. I'm just not tapping this on there just to appease people that are single in this room. But here's the deal. I want to just directly say, if you ask me, like, what about cohabitation? What about living together? Here's what I would tell you. No, don't do it. Stop. Done. You don't need to kick the tires, okay? You just need to get married. And if that's who God's calling you marry, then marry, okay? And I'm going to show you on your resource list, there's an exhaustive research article by the New York Times. It's called The Downside of Cohabitation Before Marriage. The verdict is back. It's not working. Okay, where we thought it would kind of help a marriage get better down the road, it isn't. Don't do it. We are people that have been redeemed, who've been restored. We know that Jesus is coming again when we'll be fully restored, we'll be standing in front of him, and we just can't live like that. We can't continue to do that. And which brings me to this last point, and I'm going to spend 2 minutes on it, we'll wrap up. It's glorification. It's where I believe sex is not an end unto itself. Okay. I think we as a culture have been sold a bill that tells us that we are not a whole person unless we're having sex. You're not cool if you haven't had it yet. I mean, I remember as a young person in high school, I was like, man, if I don't have sex, like, I think I'm the only one. Like, all my friends, everybody's doing it. No, if you're younger, listen to me, if you're single, not everybody's doing it, okay? Not everyone is doing it. It's not true. We are more than our sexuality, okay? By the way, if you can't be fulfilled without sex, then I'm here to tell you that Jesus wasn't fulfilled. He was single. He didn't have sex. I don't care what the Da Vinci Code tells us. Okay, he was single. All right? And we know it's crazy. We know it's crazy. Of course Jesus was fulfilled. Okay, we want to be like Jesus. And we're all on various pathways of discipleship. And for some of you here today, it's singleness. Okay? If you're single, here's what I would tell you. Single, whether you're young or old. Maybe it's divorced and now you're single. Okay, here's the deal. If you're single, endeavor to live pure. Your spouse will thank you. Okay, your spouse is going to thank you. Secondly, if you're dating and you're preparing for marriage and you're struggling, okay, to stay pure, by the way, I know that, what that was like, okay? We tell our kids, man, mom and dad get it. We understand. It was difficult being young and wanting to get married. Here's the verse you should get printed on a t-shirt and you should wear it every day, 1 Corinthians 7:9. If you cannot control yourself, then you should marry, for it is better to marry than to burn with passion, okay? I made one of those shirts. I gave it to Denise, and that's what she wore, okay, when she was 19. No, listen, we got married, okay? We got married as pure virgins, though, okay? It can be done. I want to talk to you if you are someone who's preparing for marriage or you're single. It can be done. You can get married as a virgin. You're not an anomaly. You're not a unicorn, okay? You know what I'm saying? And then the last thing I tell you about singleness is this. If you don't sense a calling upon your life to marry, then know that Paul, the Apostle Paul, commends your gift. It's a gift, he calls it. The gift of singleness with corresponding celibacy, okay? And it doesn't mean you're weird. And by the way, I'll add this too. And it doesn't mean you're gay. That's what culture's trying to, it's like, man, you get to a certain age, it's like, maybe I'm gay. No, it's not the case at all. Stop that. You don't have to wear that label. Jesus said this in Matthew 20, verse 30. He says, at the resurrection, people will neither marry nor be given unto marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven. Now, I can't expound upon that verse, but again, I'll refer back to this resource list. Randy Alcorn wrote an amazing book, this thick, on heaven. And he's distilled down into a video and an article about the question, will there be sex in heaven? Now, I can't expound upon this other than say, I hope so, you know? But this verse has been really misconstrued and oftentimes misinterpreted. And so read his article, listen to the video, that'll explain a little bit more about it. But here's the bottom line. I think suffice it to say, in the glorification, when we are standing before Jesus, before God the Father, with Jesus right at the right hand, our focus, which is much, much different than our focus here on earth. By the way, it says what, men will think about sex or sexual thoughts every like 19 seconds? You know, that's our focus, okay? I don't know about gals. I don't know how you think. But in heaven, at the glorification, our focus will not be on sex. It won't be on singleness. It won't be on marriage. It won't be on genders. It's not going to be on bodies. It's going to be on Jesus. So does this verse tell us there'll be no sex in heaven? It just says there will be no marriage nor given in marriage. And what I think is ultimately Jesus is our groom, and we as a body are the bride. And yes, I will probably, I think personally, still know my wife, Denise, as being my spouse. And I would hope that I could enjoy, matter of fact, I hope that we could all enjoy it in a pure, unpolluted state. Imagine that. But our focus won't be that. It's going to be on Jesus as the groom. And so with that, I want to end our time together. The name of Jesus is a great place to end, by the way. Jesus. You keep your focus, keep your thoughts on Jesus, and that'll take you far. Let's pray for just a moment. And what time did I say we were finishing? Did anyone know? 6:32. Okay. Okay, we're pretty close. And I don't know if there's any burning questions, but let's pray and then I'll just see if there's any kind of burning questions, and I'll hold the right to say, let's talk about that privately if we need to, but let's pray. Father, I thank you for this opportunity together. I hope it was helpful. I don't know, but I just hope that we can talk in this format, talk in this way, being open and honest with one another, dealing with what the Bible says. God, help me to have communicated that well. If I didn't in any regard, Lord, if I said things outside of what you felt like was appropriate for us as a group, then I pray that the very thing I said that wasn't right or wasn't according to your word would just fall to the ground and no ear would even remember it, and somehow it would be erased from the tape. Lord, and I don't know that would really happen, but just let there be grace in this room for one another, learning and growing together, endeavoring to be holy, to live right before you and with one another. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.